This was a joint work with my PhD student, but it was inspired by Daniele, some idea from Daniele. Now, okay. Let's try this. Okay. Now, the outline of this is okay. Well, first of all, the right time to enter refers to the right time to enter, of course, in a financial market. And to see that there is the right time to enter, well, we will see that some evidence of the mere relevance in financial markets. Then the second part will be to quantify the success of entering into the market at a given time, and then finally, how do mainstream asset pricing models cope with this phenomenon that we observe? Now, the first thing is to see what mere relation is. I'm citing something from Wikipedia because, okay, this is an informal source, of course, but the truth is that mere relation is not a mathematical concept, even if Wikipedia claims that it is. So, in general terms, the essence of mere relation is that both a stock high and low prices are temporary, and the stock price will tend to move to something called average price, equilibrium price, over time. Okay, this is not a mathematical concept in the sense that it is a stylized fact that we observe in financial markets. What is true mathematically is that there are many models which reproduce this behavior. The most simple, for example, is the discrete time autoregressive process, where the extreme plus one, a time n plus one is given by the return of time n plus something which depends on how much the return of time n is far from this equilibrium price, which is P. The minus sign is given by the fact that the price tends to return to its equilibrium price, and then there is a random disturbance that in this simple mode is given by IID random variables disturbance. Okay, here we can see a picture of these. For example, we start from 2. Let's build some point up here. Okay, the starting point is 2 here, but the reference price, the reference return is 1. So you see that the support path converge to 1, and once there, they tend to stay there. Okay? And of course, tend to stay there in the sense that when they are low, there is a driving force upwards, and when they are above, they have a driving force downwards. So they stay near 1. Okay, now mere relation in financial market in continuous time. The most simple model is the called Dodd-Stein-Gutenberg process, which was firstly employed in finance in the basic model for interest rate in 77, but there are works of more recent example, not last, the model by Consob, which is an Italian market regulator, to detect market abuses, which was of 2003. The same thing as before, because the increment in the returns are given by this term here, plus here, instead of simple random variables, we have random. Okay. Now, this is compared to the paradigm of efficient markets, Wikipedia. Okay, what is efficient market hypothesis? The paradigm that financial markets are informationally efficient. The consequence is that one cannot consistently achieve returns in excess of average market returns on a risk-adjusted basis, given the information available at the time of investment. Then there are three definitions of market efficiency, because we have a weak, some strong, and strong. Why? Well, because the basic reason is that the strongest definition is too strong. The strongest version by thesis of Fama of the 60s and formalized more mathematical terms by Paul Samuelson is equivalent to say that the recurrence are random walls. There has been much criticism to this, mainly in the 90s, by behavioral finance, partially solved by Jung-Schiller that formalized an idea that also that Postemus had, which is that this efficient market hypothesis is valid for stock prices but not for the aggregate market. For example, if we try to apply it to indices, it is no more valid. Okay. But we saw a random walk. Now let's see a sample pattern of a random walk. You see that there is okay. We have an initial point here too. We have a fixed return in time, but we have not a reference point where the random walk takes. Sense that when we have, for example, a tree, there is nothing that pushes random walk towards below or above. From here on, it's random exactly as it was from here. Okay, and this is market efficient hypothesis practice. Okay. Of course, the two phenomena contradict one another. In practical terms, with mean reverting markets, the rule of thumb by law set high should work. Okay, so buy when the asset is low, sell when the asset is high, and keep the difference. With efficient markets, there is not high or low prices in the market because stock prices are unknowable. So when you are at a given level, there is nothing that tells you the price, that price is high or low. It's unknowable. Okay. If we search for evidences of mean reversion in financial market, for example, we can plot the monthly return of Standard Poor's 500 in this time window of 35 years. Okay, can one say if this is a random walk or mean reversion process? It's quite hard to say from here. There are more efficient statistical tests to assess it. We concentrated on something more temporary, perhaps, which is quantifying the success of entering into the market. What is a good investment? Of course, if I gain, it's good. If I lose, it's bad. But then I have to quantify how good or how bad it is. So we must select a criteria. Because the most simple criteria is to maximize the return over k periods. So I buy at time t minus k, I sell at time t, which is present time. Then my return is this ratio minus 1. So it is the percentage of my gain over the amount that I invested at the beginning. Okay. Now, last time. Matter when I enter into the market. So it is possible to enter the market at the right time in order to maximize returns. To do this, one must postulate that future return depends on past quantity. Of course, this is again in contrast with the efficient market hypothesis, which says that there markets are random walls, so matter, single assets are random walls, so you cannot predict the future given the past. Okay. Let's try if this was possible in the past. Of course, this is a post exercise, but let's do it. Okay, the monthly return at IT. We compare it against the volatility in the period, observation period, which is simply the variance of the monthly return in 12 months. And we multiply for by 12 because we take the annualized volatility and plot returns against volatility. Now we have a picture where it is very difficult to say that returns here depend on volatility because volatility increases basically return does not depend critically on the volatility, qualitatively speaking. If we take a more quantitative test, there is no problem, then try with other things. And okay, Daniela's idea was try the drawdown on this period. The drawdown is defined by the maximum loss on returns on the period. That is, if I invest in any period from t minus k and t, and get the fruits of my investment before time t, then I can have a gain or a loss. So the minimum of my gain, that is the maximum of my loss, is defined as the drawdown in that time frame. This minimum is at most zero, because okay, these are meant to be less than or equal to. So here there is the return with the zero horizon, that is I buy and sell immediately. So of course my gain is zero. Okay, so the minimum between zero and any other number will be at most zero. So drawdown by definition from zero below. Okay, let's try to plot now the return against the future return against the past drawdown. So observe the drawdown up to this moment and the return from this moment to a future horizon. And these were 3 years observation before and 3 years after. Okay, we noticed a dependence. For example, if we accept any drawdown we have basically any return as before, if we accept a drawdown of at least 20%, that is, wait for a drawdown of 20% and then invest, then we notice something, we start to notice something, because observe that, okay, without observing the drawdown, that is from zero below, it's okay, we have a distribution with, for example, a minimum of minus 45% to plus 110%. If we wait until 20% drawdown, we have a minimum of 20% versus a maximum of 70%. Negative, okay, the mean is positive, but it starts to be more positive than there are more quantitative calculations. If we wait for a drawdown of 30%, we observe that, okay, if we waited for a drawdown of at least 30%, the minimum return is greater than the minimum, while the maximum is still at 55, and so on. So the more drawdown we wait, the more gain we could expect, or the more gain it has been historically achieved in this time frame from the standard deviations. Now, more precise numbers. Here is the percentage of negative return without waiting for a drawdown, then waiting for a drawdown of 5, 10, 15, and so on. And you see that the percentage of negative returns is decreasing. The mean return is okay, 23% for not waiting anything. If we waited from 20% onwards, then we will start to get an increasing mean return. Maximum or minimum, they are decreasing, but this is to be expected, because this is the percentage of negative returns, but the returns are fine, because the observations are fine. The time frame was calculated in such a way that we had 500 samples, and then the percentage of returns when one has drawdown of 5, 10, and so on was decreasing. If you come back to the picture, you see that cases when we did drawdown of 30% are 30 months in a time frame of 35 years, this one. So with these few samples, of course, the maximum return and minimum return are less than these 500 samples. because we are taking out sample points. But the crucial part is the mean return increases from a certain point on, at least. The percentage on average effective returns decreases. The volatility is quite stable because we pass from 15% to 12%. It's not so crucial that the decrease is not much. Now, how do asset prices work that are most impressive scope with this? In the sense, do common use asset pricing model succeed in reproducing this stylized effect? We selected the common use model, Black-Scholes, which is the most used. Another model, which is called constant elasticity of variance, and then extreme reverting model, such as the one you see so before, and run Monte Carlo simulation on them to see whether waiting for a given drawdown would increase the future return, as it would have been done with the standard import program. Now, the first one is the Black-Scholes model. In this case, asset prices follow the dynamics given by this geometric program motion. That is, returns are random walk in continuous time. This is consistent with the efficient market hypothesis, and to tell the truth, it's contemporary, because remember that EMH was of the 60s. This model became famous with in 73, but really it is not of them, but by Paul Samuelson. The great mistake of Paul Samuelson was that instead of applying it to European options and get a fancy closed formula, he applied it to American option, getting a difficult three boundary problem without an explicit solution. So basically, mathematicians read Samuelson model. The rest of the world read Black-Scholes. So they become more famous than, it is not called the Samuelson model, but the Black-Scholes model. But the years are the same. Okay. In fact, it is no surprise that it is consistent with the EMH. Is this suitable for an index, or better? The stylized fact that we observe is reproduced by this. We will see other two models. The second one is the CED model, which is developed by Cox Ross in the 70s. It is a variant of the Black-Scholes model where the volatility now is stochastic and depending on the VS price with a negative exponent. This means that returns are no more random walks. In particular, volatility is high when prices are low, which can be expected because if prices are low, there is more uncertainty, so more volatility. And a peculiarity of this model is that here prices can default with positive probability. So there is a positive probability that the asset price rises to zero and stays there. The last model which we analyze, the logarithm of the price, is a mean reverting process in continuous time. This is commonly used for interest rates, for commodity prices also, but and also by the consort internal model that we saw before. Okay, for each of these models, we built a software running Monte Carlo simulation on the three models to see whether waiting for a given drawdown will increase the future return, as we observed that standard report would have been happening. In this simulation, we observed the drawdown in the past three years and the future return also on the future 3 years as done historically with S&P. Okay, now, with Black-Scholes, we observed the drawdown, waiting for the drawdown from 0 to 50%. How many times, we change a bit the parameters in order to observe something more than 13.4. The percentage of negative returns is not very much varied. The mean returns also pass from 0 to 0.4, not so much. The maximum return, minimum return, we have some statistics. The volatility is not varying very much, so So basically, in the black short case, there are not these critical difference in order to, for waiting at a given drawdown. This is not a surprise because black short is random work. So the future does not influence the past. No, it's the context. The past does not influence. Okay. Statistically speaking, it's the same, but of course, when speaking in the real world, it's not. So, but anyway, okay, the past does not influence the future. So, okay, waiting for a given drawdown is not going to give many difference in our interest. Second model, CV, okay. Remember, here the volatility is stochastic, so, okay, drawdown less than 35% is. There are some risks, so we didn't observe anything below this. Number of percentage of negative return, okay, but it is not clear at all what we get here because we pass from 0.5 to something which is very similar, then increase, then decrease. So there is not a fixed dependence. The mean return also. Same thing, it is not clear, but it is clear that it is not so critical because, wait for something which happens 7 times in 35 years to have 3% more in 3 years. Perhaps it's not worth the pain. And this is in contrast with the observed data. Now, mean reality model, we have a significant sample also at 50%. Percentage of negative return passed from half of the time to 38%, not much, but the mean return instead passes from 8% without waiting anything to 23%. So there is a significant increase if we wait long enough. We don't want to wait for the 50%, let's settle for, I don't know, 30%, but we have a slight gain, 0.12 instead of 0.8, 40%, 10% more, and then there is volatility which doesn't vary very much. So, our conclusion on these pre-testing models. With the Black-Scholes model, already said the future returns are quite independent of past drawdown, so this is not a surprise because the Black-Scholes is basically random walk. With the CV model, there seems to be a dependence, but not clear in which direction, and not so critical because remember that on the mean return we have not so significant, basically. Conversely, with the mean reality model, future returns positively depend on past drawdowns, as in the standard worst 500. So, if we want a model which reflects, it's over. This was the last one. Which reflects real market behavior with this respect. So, perhaps the right model among these three is mean reality model. Of course, a more sophisticated model can be built, but the message from here is clear. Perhaps it's better to incorporate in a more sophisticated model some mean reversion. Okay, this was basically the last slide.
Are there any questions to Luciano?
Yeah, possibly suggestions. Spirit of my work is this. Try with the logarithmic random walk, but using only trajectories which are above some, say, crash level. It is to select a subsample of a trajectory which, where the market does not die, because the market has lived for 100 years.
Okay.
In that case, you are going to get a mean reversion model, even if it is not a mean reversion model that starts from.
These can have a sense in the CV model, of course, because there is a possibility, a serious possibility that market defaults. But in the Black-Scholes model, it's true that the market did not die in 100 years, but it was terminally ill in more than one time.
Yes, but this is exactly the point.
But he survived. He survived, yes. And in these terms, surviving, but in a coma, means the black box model, rather than the near relative model, is very low, and sooner or later recovered.
So the fact that you had a very big drawdown because this didn't happen, and the market still survived, makes you observe mirror working that, even if the original process is not in the world.
Yes,
but simply the, because you are here observing.
Okay, but in reality you did not condition on the fact that you are eliminated. We did not eliminate the crisis of 29 or this last of 2008. It is still there.
Yeah, in fact, this is what Barrow did. What he did was to consider all crises all over the world. And what he found is that basically USA market were very lucky. And observing US market and making US market the paradigm of the world, we undervalued the possibility of crisis simply because they did not have crisis so big to die. Other markets did die. So basically we are conditioning on the fact that they are still very important, and for this reason we study it. And this implies a structure. It's again a selection process. And this creates a little bit, not very much, of mean reversion. But if you add that the model is not Gaussian, but it is a heavy tail model, even the fact that there is the possibility of a crisis creates much more mean reversion because the probability of being in the tail is big. This is just a suggestion.
Okay, it sounds like cheating, but the person will talk better later.
Okay, any other questions? Otherwise, let's join me in thanking Tiziano. But today is not over yet.